Good morning, good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. As most people call it, Easter morning and Easter Sunday. And we're grateful that you're here with us celebrating Easter morning. And I know those of you that are learned or Bible students understand Easter or its background. But there's many Christians who do not. The word Easter is in the Bible in Acts chapter 12, verse 4. In Acts chapter 12, verse 4, the apostles were arrested and they said they were going to hold them in the King James Version to after Easter. The scripture says in the New King James, after the Passover. Easter is the Passover. And so we want you to understand that. That word Easter is translated in several scriptures, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, as Passover. Only one time in the scripture that is used as Easter. Easter comes from a pagan background, the origination and original word. It was borrowed into religion way before Christ's coming, and so it has really nothing to do with Christ. The eggs comes from the celebration of a goddess, and not only that, eggs represented new life or spring. And that's why you know Easter various months has changed from calendar year to calendar year. But we need to believe that Jesus got up. How many believe he got up? And that is our assurance. That is our peace. That is our righteousness. That is our hope that Jesus is resurrected. In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 4, notice what it says as we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday. So we'll put some scriptures up on the screen for your personal Bible study and your personal use to research the background behind this goddess and how birds was to lay upon the cake and then it produced eggs and the cake. The cross, sign of the cross, was not originated by Jesus. He was persecuted on the cross. The cross was used to persecute criminals. And anybody that broke the law, the Roman Empire borrowed that from other empires and other countries and other places and began to use it as punishment. But 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also you have received and wherein you stand. How many know we ought to stand on the gospel concerning resurrection? We use Easter as a word sometime to bait and switch, to draw attention to those who have programmed themselves towards that holiday. And that holiday, you see the whole world celebrate and hunt for eggs and all of those things. We as believers don't need to hunt for eggs, and we don't need to hunt for Jesus because he's resurrected, and it's according to the gospel. Verse 2 of 1 Corinthians 15, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Verse 3, for I declare unto you, first of all, that which I also receive, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Verse 4 says, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day. How did he do it? According to the scriptures. We skip down to verse number 12. And we'll see in verse 12, it tells us about Jesus' resurrection. And if Christ has not gotten up, then our faith is in vain. And we need to know that Jesus is Lord and Jesus is resurrected and Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father. And that's why we as believers celebrate. That's why we are believers on Sunday morning. We come together, and it's unfortunate we haven't been able to come together. However, it doesn't take away from the fact he got up. Glory to God. And so I'm a believer. Are you a believer? And we can celebrate right there in our homes. Verse 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? Do you know there's still people that don't believe that Jesus was resurrected? And so I will share with you in this programming pictures, the tomb and places that we visited. And not that is the identical place. We don't know. the Catholic Church and those of old have identified by going back into Jerusalem, and archaeologists have dug and found these places. And so therefore they labeled them. At least we have a pictorial, a vision of Jesus getting up. And we ought to learn how to trust him, and not only trust him, obey him. Verse 13, 14, but if there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. How many believe today that Jesus got up from the dead? How many accept the fact that he got up? Those of us that are believers, this morning we worship him. This morning we praise him. This morning we obey him. This morning we trust him as our Lord and Savior. And we believe that he saved us to the utmost, Hebrews 7:25. And Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercessions for us. So I hope you enjoy this resurrection service with us. Enjoy what we're going to present to you. We're going to start off with one of our dances from our previous Easter or resurrection program. And I use Easter interchangeably. I do that purposely and sometimes in error, but I want to do it to make sure you understand the word Easter in Acts 12:14 meant Passover. We're going to celebrate the Passover. So let's enjoy this dance from our dance group, and then I'll come back with the story of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. God bless you. Thank you so much for being here. This is an exciting day and an exciting time. So stay tuned for the dance from the dance team.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the second part of our programming. I'm grateful again you're here. Hopefully you're enjoying these hymns of old, Trust and Obey, Blessed Assurance. We thank God for the Word. And how many know we got to learn to trust God? I'm going to begin to illustrate to you the death, the burial, the resurrection. I start in John 18, where Jesus is now being persecuted. Verse 18, chapter 1, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook of Kedron, if you will pronounce it that way, where was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples. So Jesus goes to a familiar place to begin to pray and ask God for his will and his purpose, his direction. It's not that Jesus didn't understand he would die, but where do I die? Whether in the Garden of Gethsemane, alone with my disciples, but if I be lifted up from the earth, glory to God, I will draw all men unto myself. So let's follow Jesus as he goes into this garden and into a spot alone to pray. Verse number 2. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus oft times resorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, comes to him with lanterns and torches. Remember, Judas is coming so that he can betray Jesus. It says in the New King James, Judas, having received a detachment of troops and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. That's why Jesus was praying so hard. Do I die tonight? Or will you redeem it? You'll find the story in Matthew 26, 36 through 43, Luke chapter 22, verse 39 through 53, where Jesus prayed, not my will, but God, is your will be done. Where Jesus prayed, where sweat came off his face like drops of blood. Bible says, distressed. And so heavy in heart, I came to die. But do I die in secret? Do I die when people come privately to kill me? Or will I go to Calvary? That's the if it's be your will. Verse 4 tells you, Jesus knew the will of the Father. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, whom are you seeking? So after you read Matthew's and you read Luke, John explains and gives more detail. Verse 5, they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I am he. And Judas, who betrayed him, also stood with them. Now, when he had said to them, I am he, the Bible says they drew back, verse 6, and fell to the ground. So while Jesus is here in this garden alone, praying, seeking the face of God, his enemy comes. And look at the power of God's words when he speaks. They fall to the ground like dead men. You got to know when you're in your place of prayer and you're in your place of worship, when you're in your place of reverence, when you're in your place alone seeking the face of God, God is with you. And all you got to do is speak a word. Your enemy will recognize that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Verse 7 says, and when he asked them again, whom are you seeking? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. Verse 8, Jesus answered and said, I told you that I am he. Therefore, if you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled, which he spoke of those who gave me that the Lord has given me and God has given me, I have lost none. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I'm going to skip down to some other verses here as we see that Jesus in the garden has experienced his conflict, have experienced his trial, has experienced his test. And what did he do? He spoke a word. We're going to skip down to verse number 18 or verse 28 in chapter 18. And we're going to begin reading there. And we're going to deal with Jesus' crucifixion. So take a moment of pause, take a moment of reflection before I pick up in the next passage. I'll be right back. I'm back with you to share the next portion of Jesus' trial and triumph on earth. We've already experienced the Garden of Gethsemane. We've experienced them coming at night. Now Jesus is led to Pilate's judgment hall to stand in the gap for us. He is the Rock of Ages. He is the one that covers us. He's the one that died for us. Verse 28, in Pilate's court. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas to the Praetorium, and it was early morning. Early morning mean Tuesday, and it gives it away when Jesus was crucified, but Tuesday, early morning, because they arrested him at night in the Garden of Gethsemane. But they themselves did not go into the Praetorium, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. See, the Passover, remember that, is a holy day and a holy convocation prior to the Sabbath, as the King James shares, but it was the Passover. Jesus ate the Passover early, Tuesday, and he went into the Garden of Gethsemane. Pilate then went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? They answered and said to him, if he were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him up to you. Pilate said to them, you take him and judge him according to your law. They said, Therefore the Jews said to him, it is not lawful for us to put anyone to death. Look, they wanted Jesus dead, but didn't want to do the job. And so they had to use the Roman Empire to keep their hands clean. That the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, they said, which he spoke, signifying by what death he would die. Then Pilate entered the Praetorium again, called Jesus and said to him, are you king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, are you speaking for yourself about this, or do others tell you this concerning me? Pilate answered and said, am I a Jew? For your own nation and chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done? How many know Jesus hadn't done anything? He was without sin, but he came to redeem us. Jesus answered, my kingdom. Anybody remember this from the message? What in the world? My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Jesus came from somewhere else to redeem us. Jesus came from heaven. Corinthians write that he left his riches in glory and he became poor so we might be made rich. He came down through 42 generations as is written in the scriptures. 1,680 years. Jesus was there in the beginning. My kingdom is not of this world, but I came to redeem man. God had a plan for us way before Adam sinned. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, John 3:16, that whoever believes in him shall not perish. Glory to God, but have everlasting life. Jesus says, I'm not from here, but I'm going back. Praise the Lord. Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? Jesus answered, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness of the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate said to him, what is truth? See, that's what we have to decide between our Easter celebration. Are we going to keep hunting for eggs or are we going to hunt for Jesus? What is truth? What have we picked up from religion and all of these things and paganism that we've introduced into the church? What is truth? Is it about eggs? Is it about Easter? Is it about hunting for eggs? Or are you looking for Jesus? He's calling you. Jesus is saying to you, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. My yoke is easy. Glory to God, and my burdens are light. Pilate asked, what is truth? And when he said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, I find no fault. Come on, what did he say? I find no fault in this man. Let's pick up again, and we'll come back to this, where Jesus now stands in judgment. And the testimony is, I find no fault. But still, as he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, he has to go to Calvary. Still, he has to be lifted up. Glory to God. And if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Let's go over to the 19th chapter. Pause here for a moment. And then we're going to pick up at the 19th chapter of John. Thank you for waiting for our next section and following me as we tell the story of Jesus, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Hopefully the pictures that's up on the screen will help you to understand and get a visual of what Jesus went through. Picking up in chapter 19, verse 1, after Jesus is being scourged and persecuted, prosecuted for nothing, for no wrong, but taking our place. Let's pick up in verse 1 as he's led to Calvary. So then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, and the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe. They said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they struck him with their hands. Pilate then went out again and said to them, Behold, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him. Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns, the purple robe. Pilate said to them, Behold the man. Therefore, when the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, saying, Crucify him! Crucify him! Pilate said to them, You take him and crucify him. I find no fault in him. The Jews answered and said, We have a law, and according to our law, he ought to die because he had made himself the Son of God. How many know he was the Son of God? yet they didn't believe. Verse 8 says, therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was more afraid. Because now they're proclaiming. How many know those that don't believe in Jesus have to always remind you that they don't believe in Jesus. They don't believe in God. So they always bring them up. And inside of them, there ought to be reverential fear, understanding that my Savior, he lives. Jesus did live and come. And sometimes we don't call on him until it's late in life. Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was more afraid and went again into the praetorium and said to Jesus, where are you from? Come on, what did he ask him? Where are you from? Remember, Jesus said, my kingdom is not from this world. I am not from here. So Pilate said, where are you from? But Jesus gave him no answer. Then Pilate said to him, are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have power to crucify you and power to release you? Notice what Jesus said. Jesus answered, you could have no power at all against me unless I have had given, it had been given to you from above. Therefore, one who delivered me to you has the greater sin, saying to the leaders, the chief priests. And from then, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, if you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend. Whoever makes himself a king against Caesar. When Pilate therefore heard that the saying, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judgment seat in the place that is called the pavement. But in the Hebrew tongue, it is called Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation. It was the day of preparation of the Passover, about the sixth hour. And he said to the Jews, behold your king. It was about midnight. The Jewish days went from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m, 6 p.m. to 6 the next morning, 12 and 12, 24 hours. And so they sang on Tuesday night. They sang to them, behold your king. And notice what they say. But they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, shall I crucify your king? Being facetious. The chief priest answered, we have no king but Caesar. Look how they want to accept the Roman Empire when it's convenient for them and not accept Jesus. How many of us have made that decision to accept the status quo instead of accepting Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior? Then they delivered him to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and led him away to the cross. And he, bearing his cross, went about to a place called the place of skull. It is called in the Hebrew, Golgotha. There'll be pictures up on the screen showing you Golgotha's heel as I visited Jerusalem, the pictures that I'm sharing to you to bring you a visual of what Jesus went through. There is a picture of the cross. And what we see as a pretty cross and gold things around our bodies and et cetera, even in the Eastern pagan, they had a different type cross. Crosses were used for crucifixion. You'll see that. You'll see Golgotha heel. And not only that, we're going to see the tomb. Glory to God. But let's keep reading. They took him to Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him. And Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, writing this, what it said, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, and the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. You need to remember that, because where he was buried was beneath, right at the bottom in the garden, right at the bottom of Golgotha Hill. They buried Jesus. The place was near the city and was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but he said, I am. the King of the Jews. That's what you ought to write. Don't write it, but say that he said he was. Pilate answered and said, "What I have written, I have written. It's on you now." Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments, made four parts to the each of the soldier and a part of his tunic. Now his tunic was without seam, woven from top in one piece. They said that therefore among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots whose it shall be, and the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them. For my clothing they cast lots. Therefore the soldiers did these things." Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Not because of what they did, because Jesus endured the cross for the joy that was set before him, despising the shame. Glory to God. We'll get to the part where he sat down at the right hand of the Father. We give him praise. While Jesus on that cross spoke several words, his mother being at the cross, verse 25, and when he saw his mother, he says in verse 26, "Woman, behold your son." Then he saw his disciple John, and he said to John, "Behold your mother." Other words, now you're one in the body of Christ. You're made, you're connected together, your family. Somebody go ahead and praise God that we're family. One of the last words Jesus says here at Calvary, verse 28. And after Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scriptures might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." He had a thirst. He had a need. He had a desire. They give him vinegar. And most people think out of mockery, but vinegar was for pain relief because he bore our sins and he took the pain. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we're healed. And so when Jesus said he thirsted, they gave him vinegar. Put it to his mouth. Verse 30 says, so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." Bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Jesus, before they could kill him, said, "I give my life. No man is taking it." Somebody praise the Lord. I said, go ahead and give God the praise and give him the glory that Jesus gave his life for us. He died for us. Praise God. But he didn't stay in the grave. Hallelujah. I said, he didn't stay in the grave. At the cross, episodes happened. Things happened. Burden was there. Heaviness was there. And he died. Glory to God. But we're going to get to the part where Jesus got up. But he gave up the ghost. Verse 31, they pierced him in the side, and out of his side comes blood and water for the healing of all nations, for the redemption of sin. Without the shedding of blood, there is no redemption of sin. He was the sacrifice lamb that Abraham said in Genesis, my father will provide himself a lamb. He was the lamb that John says in John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. They prepared to put him in the grave. Therefore, because it was preparation day, that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath. For the Sabbath was a high day. It explains the day of preparation. Not the normal Sabbath, not Saturday the Sabbath, but on that Thursday, they would have a recognition and Sabbath Passover meal. Matter of fact, I have pictures of when I went to Israel in one of the gentlemen's houses right there in Jerusalem. We ate the Passover. We had unalcoholic beverages and food and sang songs and clapped our hands and celebrated. And this was the norm. But Jesus died prior to their meal because he was to be the Passover lamb. He was the Lamb of God. Glory to God. So as you view these pictures and you hear the story, I want you to picture in your mind what Jesus had to go through for us. It said it was a Sabbath, a high day. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus, remember, he gave up the ghost. He gave up his spirit. He said, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit, as recorded in other passages. When they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, nobody took his life. He gave his life. They did not break his legs. Why? The scriptures had to be fulfilled. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. Anybody remember it says you are clean by the spoken word, John 15:3? Anybody remember John chapter 3? You got to be born again of the spirit and of the water. The water represents the word of God. The blood cleanses us. The word cleanses us and gives us victory. Verse 35. And he who has seen has testified, it says, and knows, have evidence. He who has seen and has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you may believe. This is John writing. These things were done that the scriptures should be fulfilled. Not one of his bones, glory to God, was broken. He was a lamb slain whole, just like the Passover lamb in Exodus chapter 12. Verse 37, and again another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they pierced. So the Bible is coming to reality. Your true resurrection, your true Easter, your true Passover. Jesus was the Passover lamb. Jesus was that cup that he raised in the upper room and said, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Glory to God. I said, do it in remembrance of me. We're going to go to the burial. I'll be back as I turn to that scripture. We'll pick up at the burial of Jesus Christ, how Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus comes in private to bury him. Stay tuned. As you look up on the pictures of the tomb, the activities that took place, the tomb right beneath Golgotha Hill. Stay tuned. I am back to share with you Jesus' burial, as his two secret or private disciples, not walking with the regular group, not following Jesus openly, comes and requests, let me bury him. In a borrowed tomb in the garden. I was privileged to go to Jerusalem and to go visit the place where they mark Jesus' birth, showing the stone. And some may say, well, that's not the true place. And how do we know is that the exact place? We may not know. But the church of old have identified, and the Catholic Church has gone and excavated ground and found certain evidence. This is where they laid my Savior. In a rock, in a cliff. Jesus is that rock. Inside of the rock. And then Jesus will come out of that rock, glory to God, and he's going to stand on the rock. In John chapter 19, verse 38, after Joseph of Arimathea being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for the fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus before the Passover, before the celebration, before Thursday. It was a Wednesday night that Jesus was put in the grave. And he stayed there 3 nights. Glory to God, 3 days. And he was resurrected. You'll find that reference. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 and several of the Gospels that share Jesus getting out of this rock. But they buried him. They asked Pilate that we might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, was with Joseph of Arimathea, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh, aloes, about 100 pounds. Anybody remember when Jesus was in the house with his mother, the wise men brought 3 gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The gold represented his kingship. The frankincense recognized his priestliness, and the myrrh was what he would be covered with when he was put in the grave. They didn't embalm in those days, and so Jesus was laid immediately in the grave, and the myrrh, the spices, were to keep the stench down. Remember Lazarus' grave? They said he'd been in there 4 days. He stinketh. But Jesus only needed this perfume for 3 days. Glory to God. He only needed to lay there, as you look at the tomb and the pictures of the tomb, just 3 days. He only needed to borrow it because it wasn't his permanent resting place. And he knew that he would get up. Glory to God. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men. Verse 40, they took the body of Jesus and bound it in stripes. Or strips, I'm sorry, of linen with the spices, the custom of the Jews, in their burial. Now, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. Didn't I say there was a garden? There was a tomb right beneath. You'll see in some of the pictures as we visit there, the lady holding up a picture of Golgotha. And beneath that hill of Golgotha, the land of Moriah, where Abraham went with Isaac, beneath that hill, there is a garden there. There was a tomb that never been used. They laid my Savior. They laid him in that tomb, but he got up. Glory to God. Now in the place he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had been laid. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day. For the tomb was nearby. Quickly, get him in the grave before we do the Sabbath. Get him in the grave before we celebrate the Passover, as you look at some of the pictures. Get him in the grave before we drink our wine and eat our bread and eat our other food. And I thank God that I was able to experience that celebration with the brother that invited us into his own home. But from there, we went to Calvary. And from Calvary, we went to the tomb. There's pictures of 2 years of this time. In 2014, my wife and a group of us with Pastor Gould and Marlon Gould and a group of pastors, we went, and this was nighttime that we got to the gravesite. And so you'll see some that are darkened. And then I went back in 2018 with a group of pastors, and we got there in the daytime. And so we were able to investigate more. We were able to sit together and talk together and pray together and commune together right there in that garden. Pastor Gould preached a dynamic message, and we all on our knees later crying and weeping and praising God, thanking him that a resurrected Savior didn't stay in the grave. How many of you are excited this day that we still, thousands of years later, are celebrating Jesus? Thousands of years later, we give him glory. Thousands of years later. I say to you, as the song is played, Jesus is calling you. Jesus is inviting you to believe the truth. Jesus is inviting you to know who he is. Praise God that he died. But praise God, he got up. Hallelujah. I'm coming back as you view the pictures and the things on the screen. We're going to celebrate his resurrection. Glory to God. Thank you for your patience as you view our screen and listen to the story of Jesus' death, burial, and glory to God, 1 Corinthians 15 and John 20, his resurrection. He got up. Glory to God. I said he got up. I love to tell this story. I love to preach this message. I love to present the gospel to those of you who are lost and those of us that embrace Jesus some time ago in our lives. We still got to go ye therefore and preach. How can they believe in what they haven't heard? How can they hear without a preacher? And how can he preach except he be sent? Let's look at the resurrection. Let's get excited. I love to tell this story. In John chapter 20, verse number 1, the tomb is empty. The pictures that you will see on the screen, the tomb is empty. We're replaying some of them so you can get a vision in your mind. He's not there. The stone had been rolled away. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark. So you can see some of the pictures, 2014. My wife is standing right in front of the tomb, some of the other pastors, and it was dark when we got there. And so we didn't get there in our travels through the daytime. As 2018, I went in the daytime to investigate. I had to run back 4 years later and see. But it was still dark early in the morning. While it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples. She had to tell the story, whom Jesus loved, which is John, and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went out and the other disciples and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciples outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw a linen cloth lying there, yet he did not go in. Verse 6, then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloth lying there, and a handkerchief that had been around his face. Anybody remember Lazarus? He came out of his grave with dead men clothes, and Jesus says, "Loose him." But now Jesus is resurrected. The angels, glory to God, has taken off the dead man clothes. And he didn't need them any longer, so he left them there right in the tomb. He left them there as a sign. I got a new name over in glory. I got a new body. I got a new life. I'm the resurrected body. That's why some of you get confused when he came back and walked with those disciples. He was dressed differently. I often talk about what Jesus had on. They put a purple robe on him as spite. They wrapped him in white linen as burial. But he came out a glorified body. Glory to God. The handkerchief had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloth, both folded together in a place by itself. I don't need these dead men clothes anymore. Praise God. I don't need this linen anymore. Praise God. Then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as of yet, they did not know the scriptures, and they did not remember, like some of us, that he must rise again from the dead. And the scripture says the third day. So we can't bury him on Friday and get him up by Sunday morning. And so it was Wednesday night, the first night, Thursday night, the second night, Friday night. Are you following me? And so Jesus had to be put in the grave. Praise the Lord. For as yet they did not know the scriptures that he must arise again from the dead. Then his disciples went away again to their own homes. They went back to see and to search the scripture, and not only that, in fear and depression, not knowing the truth. But how many know today we know the truth? Jesus said, if any man think he has eternal life, let him search the scriptures, glory to God, that he might know. I'm going to come back to John chapter 20, verse 19. Stay tuned. Thank you for staying with us. I'm excited. Glory to God, Jesus got up. How many of you are excited he got up? What a fellowship we have now. What a relationship as we gather together, as we speak with one another, as we share the gospel throughout this entire world. What a fellowship. What a joy. Hallelujah. What is a blessing to be able to depend on Jesus. Now the disciples have come together in the upper room. They've come together somewhat despondent, somewhat confused, somewhat unaware, somewhat not knowing. Is he up? Did he resurrect? Did somebody steal his body? How many know Jesus stepped in the room? Glory to God. I said he stepped in the room. You ought to give him praise. And he began to share with them, I'm here. Come on, I'm resurrected. Praise the Lord. Let's go to verse number 19, chapter 20. John chapter 20, verse 19, Jesus declares, Jesus shows his resurrected body. I'm back. Glory to God. I'm here. I'm Lord. I'm Savior. Hallelujah. What a fellowship. What a glorious joy divine when we know we can trust him. Verse 19, then the same day, at evening. Now Mary Magdalene and the other women saw him early in the morning. He was already resurrected. The first day of the week, glory to God. That's why we gather on Sunday. That's why it's no longer the Sabbath. On Saturday, the Sabbath was not made for man, but man for the Sabbath. And now that Jesus is up, and believers were not welcome in the religious sect. They were not welcome in the religious place. They in the upper room, the first day of the week. That evening, they had morning and evening worship. Praise the Lord. It said, then the same day that evening, and that evening being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for the fear of the Jews, Jesus came. Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, glory to God, peace be to you. What is peace? Prosperity, healing, safety, tranquility. Are you hearing me? So safety. Now you're in peace. I'm resurrected. My peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world give it. What a fellowship. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands. Glory to God. He showed them his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, peace to you. Come on, John 16. 33, my peace I've spoken unto you. Now he's speaking it and putting it in actuality. Peace unto you as my Father has sent me, I also send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Other words, be born again. This was not the baptism of the Holy Spirit. For those of you doctrinally are looking, saying people are not saved when they accept Jesus and have not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. The prerequisite is to be saved. The prerequisite is to be born again. The prerequisite is to believe on his name. And when you believe on his name, you and your whole house, Acts 16, shall be saved. So he breathes on them, receive the Holy Spirit. They were born again. The only way they could be born again, they were not until after Jesus' resurrection. He had to get up from the grave. And he says to them, be born again. Receive the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. And he says to them in verse 23, if you've forgiven the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Other words, just like you've been freely you receive, freely give. And he says to them, those who are living in sin and refuse to change, retain it. Hold it to them. But those that come to Jesus, heavy laden, those that come to Jesus just as they are, those that come to Jesus requesting his forgiveness, we as the church, We as believers, we as leaders have to say to them, God's forgiven you. Receive your healing, receive your prosperity, receive your deliverance, receive your breakthrough. It's not, well, you got to do these five things first. You got to do this first. No, no. Do you believe on him? Rise up and walk. Glory to God. Do you believe on him? Such as I have in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Come on, get up at this gate called Beautiful. You're at the temple begging for money, but get up. I'm giving you more power, greater power than money. Praise the Lord. Verse 24. Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, we've seen the Lord. So he said to them, unless I see his hands, the print of the nail, and put my finger in the print, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. That's where some people are today, because they haven't seen the tomb. I was privileged to travel. I was privileged to see some things with my own eyes. But I believed on Jesus way back when, nine years old. I accepted him. I accepted the preaching of the gospel. Verse 26, and after eight days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them, Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said again, peace to you. Now, y'all got to get the door shut. See, right now I'm in this studio ministering to you and the door is shut. But if Jesus was to come into this room without opening a door, that means he's a spiritual body. He's a spiritual being. And there is no natural force that can stop him. Is anybody understanding this? No weapon formed that can defeat him, and no tongue rising up. When Jesus became a spiritual body, he can live in us and dwell in us and be in us the hope of glory. Hallelujah. He walks in the door to give us hope. And whatever room you're in right now, whatever place in your life, Jesus is walking into that room saying, I am the Savior. Come on, we got to tell that story. I am your deliverer. I am your healer. I am resurrected. Glory to God. It says in verse 27, then he said to Thomas, reach your finger here and look at my hands. Reach your hands here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. And Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Hallelujah. See, sometimes we don't praise him until we see a manifestation. We don't praise him until he come in the room. We don't praise him till after something happened. But you need to believe him while you're going through. You got to know you're coming out. You need to believe him. You got to look to Jesus, the author and finisher. You got to know for the joy that is set before you. Glory to God. Jesus had to go through Calvary. He had to go through death. He had to go through the grave. But he's up now. He's resurrected. And we got to tell the truth. We got to tell the story. We got to hear his voice and know the truth and preach the truth. We got to get away from our Easter eggs and our bunnies. We got to get away from paganism and get back in Christ. Glory to God. Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you've seen me, you got the manifestation now. You've seen the manifestation. I'm visible now. You have believed. But look where the blessing comes. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe. Glory to God. See, I tried to show you some visuals. I tried to outline this story. I tried to give you a picture in your heart and in your mind. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So I tried to get some of you only going to believe unless you see it. But blessed are you that haven't seen Jesus yet. Blessed are you that haven't stood before his throne. None of us yet to be absent in body, be present with the Lord. But we're blessed right now. Glory to God. That's why Paul says in Corinthians 5, we walk by faith and not by sight. We believe by faith and not by sight. We believe because of the gospel. We believe Jesus is resurrected. Somebody ought to give him praise. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. Let me end this in the 30th and 31st verse. As John writes the story, and John tells us of Jesus' death, his burial, and his resurrection. Some of us may be sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. But how many know Jesus can resurrect you? Jesus can lift you. It's the love of Jesus. It's because of what he's done. Come on, he's lifted me, his love. Somebody ought to give him praise. You ought to give him praise that whatever part or time in your life that you accepted Jesus and excited that you acknowledged him, it's his love that lifted us. Praise you, Jesus. I said it's his love that lifted us. And John concludes everything about Jesus, every place. For those of you saying, how do we know it was there? How do we know it was at Golgotha Hill? How do we know the places that you walk are truly the places where Jesus went? It's no matter. Everything is not written. Now you got to believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, and you confess with your mouth. So once I confess it and once I believe it, doesn't matter what I've done, whatever is not retained in me, whatever is forgiven me, I'm cleansed. John writes, it's a lot that Jesus did. Most of all, he saved us. We ought to give him praise. Verse 30, 31. And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples. Prior to his death, prior to his burial, prior to his resurrection, he gave them signs. And he says to us, these signs in Mark 16 shall follow us. In his name, we cast out devils. We speak with new tongues. We lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. No deadly thing shall hurt us. Because it's Jesus that's lifted us, and he's lifted us above our circumstance, our problems, our trials and our tests. He is the head of the body and we are his body, and everything is beneath our feet. Other signs he did in the presence of his disciples, which are not written, John said, in this book. So you got to go over to Matthew's, you got to go over to John, you got to go over to Mark, you got to go over to Luke, you got to read the stories and put them all together. We got to get our message right. He died Wednesday night, early Sunday morning, glory to God, before the break of day, Jesus got up. The tomb is empty. I said the tomb is empty. Even if we reiterate some of the pictures you've already seen at night, the tomb is empty. But these are written, John said, in this book, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ. Come on, I went from 18, 19, 20, giving you the story of his death, his burial, and resurrection. These things are written so you might know that Jesus, is anybody hearing me, is the Christ. Jesus, Yahshua, is his name. And you shall call his name Jesus, he says to Mary, and he shall save my people from their sins. The name Jesus means Savior, Deliverer. Are you hearing me? Yahshua, the God of our salvation. But Jesus is the Christ. Come on, Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Son of God. Glory to God. Jesus is resurrected. Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and he is the Messiah, making intercessions. Hebrews 7:25, he saved us to the utmost, the Messiah. He said to the woman at the well, John 4, I am he. If you drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. Out of your belly will flow fountains and wells into everlasting life. These things were written so you would know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And believing, you may have life in his name. Somebody go ahead and give God the praise, give him the glory, give him all the honor. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. We surrender our lives. We surrender our all. We surrender our hope, our trust. Praise you. Praise you. Praise you. Glory to the Lamb, you're resurrected. Glory to the Lamb, you got up. Glory to the Lamb, you are our Savior. We surrender everything. We surrender our life to you. Jesus, we praise you. Jesus, we magnify you. Jesus, we exalt you. Come on, somebody join me on this resurrection or Easter morning, whatever you want to call it. But Jesus, he's up. We surrender. everything to him. Glory to the Lamb. Let's listen to the song and dance with the dancers as they celebrate Jesus' resurrection. And we were able to pull this footage from our previous celebration. And even though we're not gathered, our Savior is resurrected. Even though we're not in the same building, come on, our hearts are joined together. And the Lord watch between you and I while we're absent. How many are ready to join me to give him praise, to give him glory, to magnify his name? I will come back with communion and praying with you over your offering, but let's celebrate. Glory to the Lamb.
Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Everybody say glory to the Lamb. We sing glory.
Thank you for staying with us to the end. Thank you for sharing with us in this blessed communion, and thank you for celebrating resurrection with us and understanding the difference between Passover, Easter, and resurrection. That word used once in the Bible. But every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Every Sunday morning is the Lord's Day. In Acts 11 is first, and in throughout Acts where they first began to worship on Sunday, either 11th or 15th chapter, it was the norm that they went to the synagogue as Peter and John did. However, on this Sunday morning, we are ready to celebrate with you in Holy Communion. Jesus ate the Passover with his disciples, as I showed you some of the pictures of Passover, how we celebrated in Jerusalem in one of the Jewish guys' home, and he invited us in and we ate together. There was wine on the table. None of those bottles were alcoholic beverages. So today, standing on the promises of God, we're going to do what Jesus said. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Bible said, let every man examine himself, that he doesn't need eat and drink condemnation to his own soul. What is condemnation? If we're partaking in communion and have not accepted Jesus, then we're falsifying our relationship. And he said, that's why many could be sickly and weak and die early. Let's make sure we're right with God. So take a moment, you examine yourself, get yourself together with your family and those that are with you in the household, and begin to meditate on the goodness of the Lord. Meditate on the things God has done for us and through us and in us. And as often as we do this, we're testifying that Jesus lives on the inside of us. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the privilege and opportunity we have to share in Holy Communion. We're standing on your word. We're standing on what Jesus, you command us that we ought to do this often. And as often as we do it in remembrance of you. We thank you that each person should examine themselves and make sure they're in right standing with you. And God, to whom we forgive, we forgive it. You've forgiven us and we're cleansed through the blood of Jesus. So we forgive ourselves today. We accept your love today. We accept your grace today. And so we receive this Holy Communion together. We receive this Holy Communion, even though separate from each other, in our own home, we receive it in faith. And we give you praise. We bless the bread. We thank you for the fruit of the vine. We call it blessed. We give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible tells us the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, as often as you eat this, do it in remembrance of me. The Bible says they took it and they ate together. Then Jesus took the cup. He raised it. And he said, as often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. I'll eat and drink again with you in my Father's house. How many today on this Resurrection Sunday are you remembering what the Lord has done? Remembering him giving his body and shedding his blood. Hallelujah. Let us all drink together. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We praise you. We give you glory. Thank you for Jesus. Hopefully you have enjoyed this resurrection and Easter Sunday morning. Whichever way you want to name it, the word Easter in Acts 12 means Passover. So this is the Passover. This is the celebration. We thank God for it. The Lord passed them over in Egypt. They put the blood on the doorpost. How many got the blood on your doorpost? Praise you, Lord. So we're going to get ready to pray with those of you that are giving in your tithe and offering. I don't want to leave that out this morning. I'm excited and grateful and thankful for those of you that have responded to the Macedonian call to come over and help us to give your seed, as Moses said to the people, and help us in paying off our property, getting ready for the building. And so we thank God for you in advance. Thank God for those of you that are helping to meet budget, giving in your tithe and offering. Thank God that he's given you seed to sow. And so I'm going to pray with you today Go ahead and raise your offering before the Lord, or your hands before God. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for the privilege and opportunity of giving in our tithe and offering. We thank you as an act of obedience, Malachi 3, return to you and you'll return to us. And how have we left you? In tithes and offering. So therefore, the people were walking in a curse and you've come to redeem us. Glory to God. Through Jesus Christ, you redeem us from that curse. So we thank you that you rebuke the devourer for our sake. We thank you, 2 Corinthians 9 says, you love a cheerful giver and able to make all grace abound towards us, that we have all sufficiency of all things. You give us seed to sow and multiply the seed sown. You give us bread for our food and you increase the fruits of our righteousness. We thank you, Father. We thank you that wealth and riches are in our house, according to Psalm 112. We thank you, God, that you increase us more and more in Psalms 115. And we thank you in Philippians 4:19. But you, my God, shall supply all of our need according to your riches in glory through Christ Jesus. So we give him praise in advance that our needs are met. I bless the people. Father, I bless their homes right now in Jesus' name. I leave my peace there. I speak peace. We thank you the needs of the people, the needs of the ministry are met. And we give you glory. We give you praise. We celebrate you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you so much for tuning into our broadcast. Thank you so much for listening to this message. And we pray that this Sunday morning has been one special for you and to you. God bless you. I love you. Listen to the announcements on the way out. I want to share with you how to become a born-again believer into the Christian family. The word Christian is only in the Bible three times. Jesus' original intent was for us to become believers, to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Number one, recognize that you are a sinner and hopelessly lost without Christ. Romans 8, chapter 3, verse 12 and verse 23. It says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us need him. Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. John 3 tells us in verse 5 through 7 and verse 16, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. The second thing you need to do to become a believing, born-again Christian, believe the good news that God sent Jesus Christ to take your place, died in your stead, and paid the full penalty for sin. He was raised from the dead. So we need to believe that God has raised Jesus from the dead, that Jesus has come in our place in Romans 5 and 8, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 15, 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 17. Make sure that you read these scriptures. The third thing you need to do to become a believing Christian, born-again Christian, begin to confess this with your mouth and believe in your heart that God, through Christ, can save you. Romans 10, it tells us that if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, then we shall be saved. Whoever called upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You also see that reference in John 3, and we gave you that verse earlier. Hebrews 7:25, we know that the Lord saved us to the utmost, and today is the time for us to call upon his name. The fourth thing you need to do to become a born-again believing Christian is rely on God's word and not your own feelings or theories. Not feeling that we save is nothing that we have done, it's all that he has done. Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. 2 Corinthians 1 and 20, all the promises of God is yes and amen. Rely upon God's promises. The fifth thing, realize that you are saved by grace through faith in Christ, not anything you have done. You'll find that quoted in Ephesians and written in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For we are saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves, lest any man should boast. Also in 1 John 1 and 9 tells us, For those of you that's even coming back to the Lord, if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you from your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And so if you've done those things and you decided today that you want to accept Jesus as your personal Savior, and even those that need to recommit your life back to Him and you strayed away, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. Your word declares that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I confess my belief in Jesus, and I know that you gave and given unto me salvation. You said in your word, if I shall confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God has raised Him from the dead, I will be saved. I believe in my heart that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe He lived, died, and was raised from the dead for my justification and my salvation. I'm calling upon the name of Jesus. So I know, Father, that you save me now. Your word says, with the heart, man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. I do believe with my heart, and I confess Jesus now as my Savior. Therefore, I am saved. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. If you have done those things, today accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Do not rely on your feelings, rely on the Word of God. For those of you that are in a backslidden predicament, and today you're saying, I give my life back to you, Lord. The Bible says in 1 John, it says, if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Jeremiah 3 says that God is married to the backslider, so He never divorced you. So don't divorce Him. And so He will always receive you back. Hebrews tells us your sins and iniquities He will not remember anymore. So say this with me. Father, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your forgiveness. I believe now that I am forgiven. I come back to you humbly. I repent of my sins. I am sorry. And God, I thank you that you receive me in love. You receive me by grace. And I receive restoration in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for tuning in to our broadcast. We air our broadcast Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m. and Sundays at 11 o'clock a.m. on Facebook, YouTube, and Covenant Online. Join us every Saturday morning at 11:30 Eastern on the Now Network. Whether you're at home or on your mobile device, you never have to be away from Covenant. Download our app and stay updated with events, messages, and pertinent information concerning the ministry through the CCM app. Watch your favorite sermon series and add the Covenant Christian Ministries channel app to your television through Roku or Amazon Prime Video. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at CCM Marietta. Also, visit our website, covenantchristianministries.org. Join us online every week for a word from God through Pastor Anderson. Be sure to comment and let us know that you're watching. There are four easy ways to give to Covenant Christian Ministries. You can give online at covenantchristianministries.org. You can also give using the CCM mobile app. If you have a PayPal account, you can give directly from the PayPal app using the friend and family option. You can also go to paypal.me/covenantchristianmen. Lastly, you can always give by mail at P.O. Box 4065, Marietta, Georgia, 30061. Your support makes ministry happen. Thank you again for joining us. Have a great week.